Hello, lovies. Thank you so much for joining me on another episode of the ODAAT Chat podcast. My name is Arlina and I'll be your host. So normally I don't do this, but I just wanted to share a little bit about what's going on with me. So my son was in an ATV accident and he suffered a broken vertebrae, which was really scary, but he'll be okay. So then a couple days later, my elderly father fell and broke his hip. So needless to say, it's been a lot, and I found myself wanting to do some spiritual bypassing, like just focus on gratitude, surrender, give it all to God, all that. What I didn't want to do was feel my feelings, but you know what's helped so much is talking with these women who have been brave enough to do this step work with me. We talk on the phone, we tell the truth, and we love on each other, and for that, I am deeply grateful. And today I'm sharing a conversation that I had with one of my heart's treasures. Her name is Jen. She was actually the first one who volunteered to do the work. So this episode is a stepper call with Jen, who is sharing her step one homework. And if you want to hear more episodes like this, there are many other interviews of people in recovery who share their experience, strength, and hope. And you can find those by visiting odaatchat.com. And if you know someone who could benefit from witnessing someone transform through doing these step work calls, please share this episode with them. So with that, please enjoy this episode with my dear friend, Jen. Well, Jen, thanks so much for joining me on the ODAAT Chat podcast.
It's great to be here. Nervous, excited.
Oh, good. Let's just call it excited.
There we go. That's better. Yeah.
Changes the energy a little bit. Yeah, so you are working on step one. This is a step work call. So what I thought we would do before we start, I'd like to say a little prayer to invite our higher power in. I'm just going to call it God. Is that okay with you?
That works fine for me.
Okay, great. Dear Father, thank you so much for this time with Jen. I'm so grateful to her and her courage to be able to go through the process. I just pray that we may use this time to do your will to help as many people as possible. And I just pray that you lead us to where you would have us go and make it for the highest and greatest good for all involved. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Okay. Well, listen, I am super excited. We are on step one. We are doing the worksheets out of the book, A Woman's Way Through the 12 Steps. Is it A Woman's Way or Woman's Guide Through the 12 Steps? Anyway, it's by Stephanie Covington. So we're on step one. But before we jump into the homework that you've completed, I just thought it would be good to sort of, you know, give people a little bit of an idea of who you are. So where are you in terms of like higher power?
How I'd like to describe it, I definitely believe in something bigger and greater than myself. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's where I'm at. On,
do you call it God or?
I do. I wasn't really raised in the church. I mean, we went, you know, every so often, mm-hmm. But that's the term I'm familiar with. But definitely once I got into the program, I definitely resonated once I started hearing people share and hearing stuff going on in the rooms when people would talk about it. It's like the whole concept of really getting into a higher power is realizing that it's not just about me, you know, and there's something bigger and greater than me. For me, I can really resonate with it when just looking outside at the sky, the sun, you know, it's just obviously animals. Right. I'm a big animal lover. So I just know that there's something bigger and greater than myself out there. So that's all.
Okay.
Yes. But I definitely use the term God.
Oh, perfect. Okay, great. Let's see. And how long have you been sober now?
I've been sober 41 days, I believe. My last drink was April 13th.
April 13th. Okay. Mm-hmm. Fabulous. And you had quite a long stretch of sobriety before.
I did. I'll be 48 this July. And I've been drinking since I was in my late teens. Mm. And I got brought into the program originally 99. Unfortunately, I got behind the wheel and got pulled over for a DUI. Thank God I didn't hurt myself or anybody else. Mm-hmm. And it brought me into the rooms. And I was thankful for that. But looking back, I can see that time when I was just checking off the boxes, you know, I was doing what I needed to do. And people in the rooms, you know, told me what to do. I got a sponsor, worked with a sponsor, did all that stuff. So, but I was just basically, I was in the military and I was full-time military, and I ended up getting sent overseas to Germany. And back then I was a big beer drinker. I knew all about, you know, AAs everywhere. That I could have found meetings over there, but I didn't. So that time, I think I only had 8 months of sobriety. And when I went over to Germany, so we're talking about 99, you know, 2000, I started drinking again.
Okay.
Yes.
Got it. You've mentioned the rooms, meaning Alcoholics Anonymous?
Correct.
Okay. Correct. Just to clarify, in case someone is not in the know. You know, and I'm so grateful that you're willing to sort of play along, and I'm hoping that as somebody is witness to you going through the steps, that they might find, they'll learn something about themselves as well. Because I feel like we're all, you know, even if the circumstances are different, all the feelings are all the same, right? So I think people are going to be able to connect with the feelings. I just want to say thank you before we even jump into this for your willingness to go through the process.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I mean, that's one thing I have learned also is, you know, you hear the saying, yeah, it's the AA saying, you know, you got to give it away to keep it. But I really do. I said I was nervous, excited, you know, but sort of like an excitement, like getting on a roller coaster or something, like something you know is going to be fun.
And, yeah.
You know, it, for lack of a better example, I just thankful for the opportunity to share. Podcasts have been a big part of my recovery this time around.
Yeah.
I don't just listen to yours. Sorry.
There's so many. No,
I know.
There's so many. I have had lots of podcasts, recovery podcast hosts on my show as well.
And yes, I know you have.
I'm just so grateful for everyone who's willing to take a little time to talk about it.
Yeah. And that's one thing, like I said, I originally came into the rooms in 99. I've gone back out, but back then podcasts, it's been really nice coming back in and having the podcast to listen to.
Well, what other podcasts are you listening to?
A Sober Girl's Guide.
I interviewed her. Yes.
I know you did. I
love her. Yeah, Jessica.
Jessica is awesome. And then I just listened to your episode. You did this a while ago, I think a little over a year ago with Omar.
Oh my God.
Yes, you.
Us, it was such a nerd. I totally fangirled out. So embarrassed.
Yeah. Omar's
I love
great.
Omar. He is he is who he says he is. Like, I just love Omar.
The real deal.
He is the real deal.
And I love how he's escalated it from the Share podcast to Recovery Revolution now to where he's really changed in the scope of it to entrepreneurship and personal growth with recovery. And that's really awesome. Recovery Elevators, and that's another one. The Blue Pencil is a new one with two females.
Yeah,
there's a lot of new ones coming out with female hosts, which is really great. Unruffled is really great, and they're in California. Well, I know you're moving, but Tammy Salas is in Northern California, and then she does it with Sandra Primo, who's in Texas.
So. Oh, very cool.
Yeah.
The dynamic duo. Love it. Okay. Thank you for that. I will certainly put links to all of these in the show notes on the odaatchat.com website. So thanks for that. Okay. So if you're ready, we can just jump into your homework. So we started with step one, and I had you define powerlessness and unmanageability. Do you want to read those definitions for me?
Sure. So I just went straight for Googling it, each word. Powerlessness, it's like a lack of ability, influence, or power. Like, I could definitely relate to that. It's having no power. Mm-hmm. Unmanageability, I have a difficult of or impossible to manage or manipulate or control.
Manipulate, interesting.
That's what came up. Yeah, manipulate. Lack of control.
Yeah. Okay. And let's see. So what were some of the examples? I'm probably just going to, we can just talk about it. The readings were step one from the 12 and 12 and Bill's story from the Big Book. Step one is about awareness and unmanageability. We need to become conscious of our feelings, our behaviors, and their effects on other people and ourselves. The opposite of awareness is denial. When we deny something exists, we can't change it. Only when we tell ourselves the truth, risk seeing ourselves as we are, can we begin to make changes. Step one helps us to come to the conclusion on a deeper level, all the ways our alcoholism makes us hate ourselves so we can eventually drink to ease the discomfort. So what were some of the examples that you had for powerlessness and unmanageability as it relates to your alcoholism?
Ooh. Where to begin? I have a lot of examples. With my timeline, you know, I have an extensive history with alcohol. So with my timeline, though, I'll begin with give you a most recent example.
Mm-hmm.
So this is almost a year ago. I'm in the Army Reserves, and we do 2 weeks of training. And it was 5 days into this training. It just happened to be my birthday. So that evening, we got done with training, and a handful of us wanted to go to the beach and get something to eat. We had gotten permission to take the government van, and on the way there, we stopped at a convenience store to get snacks and, of course, alcohol. Just sidebar, drinking's pretty prevalent in the military.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Kind of prevalent everywhere.
Exactly. You know, it's just prevalent in society. It doesn't matter what your job is.
True.
But it was going on. So we got to the beach, and I drank, and I didn't eat much that day. Not smart. I ended up making another food and alcohol run with one of the guys. There was also a couple females there I was with. I remember opening the new bottle of vodka. This was after already having a couple drinks and drinking right out of it. I also remember calling my mom and struggling to not slur my words.
Mm.
Yeah, nice. I passed out in the van on the way back. I remember when we got back and I got out of the van, I needed help walking to the barracks. This part gets pretty embarrassing and will definitely show in powerlessness and unmanageability. So I ended up not making it to the bathroom and ended up wetting myself.
Mm.
Before we went, I went on this annual training, I had been concerned about my drinking and I had stopped drinking for 5 days. So a lot of my feelings of inadequacy and wanting to fit in influenced taking that first drink. Because mm-hmm. there was another guy there that not only stayed sober because he was the driver, you know, we were smart enough to have a designated driver. He just wasn't a drinker.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, majority of the people there were drinking. So that influenced me taking that first drink, which led to the powerlessness of drinking to excess.
Right.
Like we hear here in the rooms, you know.
No that control first, to moderate it. And,
yeah, that first drink, you know.
Yeah, and I would imagine that must have been such a humiliating experience, you know, at the end there.
Yeah, it was because I still had to work with these people, you know, for I was only 5 days into a two-week train.
Goodness.
Yeah. Yeah, no one really looked at me too funny the next day. So,
said anything?
No, no one really said anything. So
that was nice.
Yeah. So I got lucky that way. And, mm-hmm. you know, and I know I'm not alone in embarrassing.
Oh, girl, please.
Yeah.
Come on now.
So,
yeah.
Yeah. Just goes to show, though, the powerlessness of, and unmanageability.
Yeah. Like, seriously, you never would have done that had you not been drinking.
No.
Yeah.
No.
That never would have happened.
No.
I mean, think about it. Like, have you ever peed your pants when you were stone cold sober?
No.
Since you got out of diaper? Yeah, no, that just doesn't happen.
No.
Yeah. Okay. Do you have any other examples you want to go over? What else did you write?
Let's see, what's another? Let me jump to this one. I can just probably say without even really looking at my notes. Something I realized doing this work, looking at my drinking history. So this goes back to the summer of my 16th birthday. So it's one of the first times I drank. My mom was out of town. I grew up with a single parent household. And I had a younger sister, 15 years younger than me. So big age difference.
Oh, 15 years. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know what that means? I got stuck with a lot of babysitting.
Right.
So this one incident, but this one, while my mom was out of town, was I was staying with my friend, and she had a boyfriend, And then we came back to my house and her boyfriend was with us. And then there's this house up that my friend's boyfriend thought it'd be a great idea to break into that house. Because we knew no one was staying there. So me being, you know, wanting to fit in and, you know, not
right.
just say, hey, that's not a good idea, you know, I went along with it. And where the drinking falls into that and is there was alcohol in the house and we decided to take all the alcohol
mm-hmm.
and then go back down to my house and drink. And I remember I was so drunk that I tried to open one of the glass windows and I was so drunk that my hand just went right through it.
Oh my
God. Yeah, I have a scar in the palm of my left hand from that.
Wow.
Yeah, so that just shows
unmanageability for sure.
Yeah, and just powerlessness. You know, yeah. I took that first drink and I just kept drinking. But it was easy to chalk that up to, oh, a teenager, you know, so that's
right,
why.
Yeah.
You know, what was it, you know, alcoholism or just being a teenager? But I had, you know, there's another incident where I was babysitting my sister and a female friend of mine came over and we came up with the idea of, you know, wanting to go get some alcohol. So I packed up my sister in a friggin' stroller and we walked a mile to go get some alcohol. We stood out of this convenience store till we could find someone to buy some alcohol.
When you guys have a little baby in a stroller?
Yeah.
How old was your sister at that time?
Oh, my God. So she had to be, I was 15, almost 16. You know, she was.
So she was a baby.
Yes. She wasn't even a year old, probably. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, so it sounds like you were left with a lot of responsibility at an early age.
Yeah. But it wasn't all that bad. I was still allowed to have a lot of respect for my mom. You know, being a single parent. Mm-hmm. And I was still able to play sports. Sports was the big thing. Mm-hmm. I love sports and still do. I was really into softball. Mm-hmm. And then I was also in the band. So I was a sport and band geek.
That's awesome. What instrument did you play?
So actually I played cool instrument, percussion, drums.
Oh, okay.
So
very cool.
Yeah, so I actually know how to play drums.
Very cool.
And I actually did a little stint where I dropped out of high school and it was actually my senior year. And I actually played with an all-female band down in Hollywood.
And cool.
Yeah, we actually played in the club, but we just couldn't keep it together. Too many females and drama to keep it together.
Right, yeah. Yeah, that's pretty cool, though.
Yeah, but yeah, I love music. Yeah.
Very cool. And what happened with your sister after you got the alcohol? Was there a consequence after that when you had your little drinking with your little baby sister around?
Oh yeah. It was peppermint schnapps of all things.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God.
Has to be something.
Yeah. So we got the bottle of peppermint schnapps, came back to the house and I don't remember much. I mean, it was so long ago, but I'm sure it's also because of the alcohol. What I do remember is my mom yelling at me.
Oh, yeah.
Waking me up because I was asleep.
Passed out?
Yeah. I guess the house was a mess. You know, I was supposed to clean up and do dishes and stuff and fold laundry and none of that was done.
And be watching your baby sister.
Be watching my sister. Yeah.
What was she doing when you passed out?
My sister, thank God, nothing ever happened. I mean, I'm pretty sure I put her to bed.
Oh, okay. So it was in the evening.
Yeah, it was in the evening. My mom worked at a restaurant in the evening. So yeah, it was definitely the evening.
Oh, okay. Good. Okay. Yeah. Well, very good. Do you have anything else?
I have three or four incidences. I mean,
let's get into it.
Okay. I can keep on going with the fun here.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's good. It's good to have examples, you know. How, you know, it's just amazing. I don't know. My husband's friend says that we have like a BS filter in our elbow. And when we start writing and we get like these stories out on paper, it's, you know, we see it in black and white and it's hard to be in denial about the effects of alcohol on us once we start getting some of it out.
Yeah, it is. And that's why I love doing it this way. Mm-hmm. It's because I remember thinking, okay, well, the only step that you really need to write is what, step four, you know, doing the moral inventory. You know, that's the only step you would think you'd have to write. Or was it step eight, where you make a list of all people you've harmed and make amends?
I have a homework assignment for every step.
So I've had a sponsor where it's just basically, no, it's just step four, you know, so it's
interesting.
You could write on step one.
Yeah. It's kind of interesting. And I think this will kind of come out as we do these calls, as you know, everybody seems to do it different. You know, I had a guy on the podcast who said, you know, his sponsor asked him, you know, are you powerless over alcohol? Is your life unmanageable? And the answer was yes. And then, do you believe that a higher power can restore you to sanity? And he was like, yeah. Are you willing to turn your will in your life over to care of God? And he was like, yeah. And he goes, okay, let's get into the inventory. And I was like, really? You didn't digging up the past? And anyway, I just think it's, listen, there's a wrench for every nut, right? So
yeah.
People used to get sober writing letters to each other.
When
it started in the Hazelden group back east, you know, people were writing letters. But anyway, I just find it helpful to sort of really kind of pull all that stuff out, because I find that it's helpful as we go through the steps and as you move through life, you know, about how the effect, cause and effect is what we're really getting at. So,
yeah. And then writing is a good thing anyways. Journaling and stuff. Yeah. And that's something I'm trying to get into this time around too.
Good.
My recovery. Yeah. So this is helpful.
Good.
So my next incident is bringing it back to about a year and a half ago. So this is when I was full-time for a year with the Army Reserves. So I'm in Washington State now. And we got put on a year orders to go down to Fort Bliss, Texas. So we were down there for a year, and I, of course, drank a lot, and it was became obvious that I had too much to drink and needed help to my room. When I got to my room, I tripped trying to take off my shoes and socks. I fell and hit my side of my face on the corner of my nightstand.
Oh, man.
Yeah. I got seriously lucky because I was alone in my room.
Oh, you were.
Yeah. So I got a scar right here. Luckily, I didn't have to have any stitches. So there's a little bit of a scar on the top of my right cheek.
Okay.
So, yeah, I'm lucky I didn't, you know, fall harder or poke my eye out and do something really bad.
Yeah, it could have been worse.
Yeah, it could have been a lot worse. So, you know, that obviously shows, you know, how powerless I was when I started drinking and how unmanageable my life was. I couldn't even make it to my room or take off my own shoes and socks without, you know, injuring myself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that's scary.
Yeah, it's just real scary. I remember falling down a flight of brick stairs because I was so drunk. Yeah, I lost my balance opening the screen door, and I fell backwards down a flight of brick stairs. Wow. So, I mean, yeah, this definitely wasn't the first time I physically hurt myself drinking.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Seems to be a... Did you hear the dog? Sorry.
Yeah, no, it's cool.
Old dog Max. Okay, let's see. So that's really exercise one is about awareness. And on the sheet, it says to begin on your knees with a prayer to your higher power, asking for clarity and direction. Then sit back and reflect over the last few weeks or months. Write down all that you feel powerless over and all that is making your life unmanageable. Include thoughts, feelings, behavior patterns, actions, and anything else. So I feel like that pretty much covers it. Was there anything that we left out or anything else that comes up for you?
No, just that it was, this exercise really helped me see, I'm powerless over alcohol. You know, once I take that first drink, I won't stop. I'll continue.
Yeah.
But it's like this exercise has also helped me look at, okay, well, why do I take that first drink?
Oh.
Yeah, so...
Do you have an answer for that?
It's becoming clear, I've heard this term so many times, so I'm trying to find a different term, but just not feeling comfortable enough in my own skin.
Sure. Yeah.
In like social situations to just say, no, alcohol is not good for me. Something else I've realized coming back into recovery and reading so much that's out there, the denial ninja. You know where I'm going with the yep.
Yeah. I was the first one to call her that.
Woo-hoo. Yep. I know. Yeah, it was cool. And just realizing what a toxic substance it is.
Yeah.
You know, it's not, I don't have an issue saying I'm an alcoholic, but it's, alcohol isn't good for anybody. It's ethanol. Yeah, yeah, it's ethanol.
Poison.
Whether you can handle just drinking one and that's all you're going to drink, it's still not good for you.
Right.
So noticing that, okay, well, what drives me to pick up that first drink is, you know, not just feeling comfortable enough in my own skin to just to be okay in social situations. But yet I've been able to do go over to friends' houses and, you know, luckily they're not big drinkers themselves, but not feel like, oh, I need a drink, to realize that I'm fine just the way I am. I don't need to drink to loosen up, because that's not going to be the real me anyways if I'm drinking. You know?
That's a really good point. It's not the real you anyway.
Yeah, it's just not, you know.
Yeah.
So I've gotten into meditation and yoga.
Oh, good.
I've always been into exercise. So I use all these things to just calm myself and to just be okay in my own skin and realize everything, you know, is going to be okay. I don't need the so-called social lubricant to deal with life. But there's a lot to it, you know. Sometimes I can use the excuse, oh, I've had a long week. Oh, I deserve a drink, you know.
Well, sure.
Why? Why do I deserve something that's not good for me? No, you know, I can, you know, enjoying looking for substitutes like tea, you know, just kombucha, a whole bunch of different stuff out there.
Oh, kombucha.
Oh, yeah.
Definitely. A little bit of controversy with the kombucha.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah. Maybe I should. Yeah,
maybe stay away from the kombucha. I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay. The only reason I say that is because I have a friend who relapsed, and she started.
Really?
Yeah, she started with the kombucha, and then she kind of escalated to other things. It was kind of a slippery slope. And listen, there was other things going on, but it's like if you have all kinds of other options, you know, why choose something that might lead you down the slippery slope? So
exactly. Yeah, so like right now I'm drinking my Bliss Reduced Stress. You get them from Safeway.
Very good.
It's good. Vitamin D, a whole bunch of good stuff in there. Yeah, it's got chamomile in it too.
Oh, very good. Very relaxing.
Yes. So there's so much out there that's you know, better for you to drink.
Absolutely. Okay, so let's see, exercise too. What are some examples of your behaviors or actions that have come to light that you're feeling powerless over as a result? So I'd be interested to hear how you interpreted exercise too. Do you have other behaviors or actions that have come to light that you feel powerless over as a result? Is it like finances or relationships or...
As a result of when I'm drinking?
Yeah, like be dishonest or try to, you know, image management was something that I was reminded of this morning. You know, sometimes after doing something to embarrass myself, the next day I feel the need to overcompensate, right? Like try to do damage control or, you know, try to manage how other people see me. You feel the need to do damage control or anything?
Well, I've noticed that if I am drinking, which my wife definitely doesn't like. So I've noticed back when I was drinking that I would do stuff, go out of my way to make sure everything was okay. Oh, she has a big sweet tooth. So, pick her up a candy bar. Looking to be more helpful around the house, just trying to
out of guilt.
exactly.
Yeah.
You need me to pick you up lunch, and just doing stuff without even asking that, yeah, of course, that's nice. But I know in the back of my mind, my motive.
Yeah.
And we won't even get into the times that I would use the sweet tooth to like that she has to make runs to the convenience store to go pick up alcohol.
Yeah.
And to hide, and I was hiding my drinking too.
Hiding my drinking, yeah.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. I mean,
the things we do.
Yep. So definitely powerlessness and unmanageability when it comes to that. Definitely okay. hit my alcohol drinking. I would do stuff to do damage control.
Damage control. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So exercise theory, describe the negative consequences and destructive behavior caused by all of the things in exercise two that you're feeling powerless and unmanageable over. So this has a few different parts to it. So how does this affect your daily life? How does this affect your health, your self-esteem, how you are a part of the world? Is this affecting your life goals and impeding your spiritual progress? So, we can take these one at a time or just address whatever is coming up for you.
Well, what just came up for me was the last part you were saying, the spiritual progress, right?
Yeah. Is this affecting your life goals and impeding your spiritual progress?
It's definitely impeding my life goals.
Mm-hmm. What life goals do you have?
That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Oh, yeah.
And I've realized that it's okay to not know what my goals are right now because having 41 days this time of sobriety, you know, I'm trying to figure it out. Like, I've just started yoga in the last not even a year.
Mm-hmm.
So getting out there and trying and doing different things. And that goes into, you know, my spirituality and stuff and find out all that and meditation and stuff. And I'm hoping continuing to do that stuff, life goals will become clearer.
Yeah.
I'm going on a retreat next weekend. It's a weekend retreat, silent meditation retreat.
Oh, very brave.
Yeah. Yeah. so there's ones that are like a week, 2 weeks, up to like 3 months and stuff. Yeah, I
would
imagine.
Die. Podcast host.
You got to be talking. That's what you do. But so I'm looking forward to it. And yeah, I'm just doing it's for beginners. So I'm just doing a bite size for a weekend. And
okay.
And to be able to meditate and listen and to see what comes up to me and to get some life goals. My drinking. My health is an issue, and drinking definitely does not help.
Wow.
It raises my blood pressure. I've had to be on blood pressure medication.
Okay.
I have hypothyroidism. In fact, I have to have a biopsy coming up next month on my thyroid because there's a nodule of growth.
Okay.
There's nothing that the doctor's too worried about, or else he would have got me in there sooner for a biopsy, but it's still a concern.
Okay.
But the thyroid, I'm not sure if you know a lot about it, but it definitely affects your hormone and fatigue levels.
Sure.
And that was another excuse why I used to drink. Oh, I have fatigue. I've worked, you know, so hard. And drinking would help me forget about the fatigue. I mean, I would be drunk or, you know, so I wouldn't really care that, oh, I'm so tired and fatigued and have low energy.
Mm-hmm.
I was, in a sense, self-medicating.
For sure.
Yeah. So, but I've had goals to get my health, just realized that is one of my goals, is to get my health regulated when it comes to my thyroid and my blood pressure and my weight. I need to lose a little bit of weight. And then my thyroid being out of whack makes it a little hard.
It does. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, but certainly drinking doesn't help that. So
exactly. So
yeah, no, those are good life goals, and I think it's so important to, you know, look in your past and think about, you know, when in my life did I feel joy or what were the things that I was doing that brought joy into my life, and try to make a connection to what could I bring forward into my everyday, present day, and future.
Yeah, the music and talk. Remember we were talking about
sports music and
Yeah, I need to get back into that. And I have a membership at our community center that's like I can walk there. And they have a little studio and they have drums there and everything. So I need to get back into that. And that's definitely a time where I was, you know, really happy playing music. So.
Playing music, yeah.
Yep. And drinking, I definitely wasn't even thinking about doing that.
Right. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Steals all the joy.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that pretty much covers it. Was there anything else that you wanted to share? Or do you feel like we kind of covered how the different ways that alcohol relates to the powerlessness and unmanageability?
I'm just enjoying having all these epiphanies and getting a little bit clearer about it. You know, that just drinking just was sucking away me realizing my life goals and, you know, just, yeah. And then that just makes my life unmanageable.
Yeah.
It's just a journey.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one I'm excited to be on, but I'm still, you know, like I said, with my thyroid and everything, another symptom of it is a brain fog. So that's why I can sound a little bit scattered at times too.
Okay.
And I'm sure being newly sober, being 41 days, you know, it just, that plays into effect too. So
for sure.
So I'm still, you know, getting used to being physically, I mean, I've heard different things, you know, it takes 10 days for the actual physical stuff of alcohol to be out of your body, you know, 2 weeks or whatever. But but then you hear, you know, post-acute withdrawal symptoms can last, you know, over a year. So,
wow.
Yeah. I've definitely done a lot of reading too.
You have. No,
yeah,
that's
with
good.
My time. Yeah. Podcast, reading.
Yeah. No, it's good to feed your brain. I mean, and especially if you're spending time on the solution, you know, your brain doesn't have the opportunity to, you know, sometimes like the inner critic can be really loud. So when you're focused on something positive, it sort of drowns out that inner critic. So that's really good to feed your brain good information.
Yeah. And it's just helping me stay focused, you know, since I have, past reading and then the online community, you know, there's so many sites.
Oh my goodness.
The secret Facebook page. I've seen you on there. So it's nice to be able to know that you're not alone and to use all those tools. And it just helps keep me accountable, because I can get on my Facebook and I have all my secret Facebook feeds going on there. So
right,
it's like, and I got my sobriety counter on my phone. It's like, come on, what am I going to do? Go drink? Come on. No.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. No, it sounds like you're creating an environment that supports your recovery. So you're on the right track.
Yeah, I'm still working on that in real life. I definitely, you know, I go to AA once or twice a week. I need to go to different meetings. One meeting that's really close to my house that I go to. It's one of those meetings I'm sure you've been to where it's kind of noisy, people coming in and out. Not really focused on the message.
It's distracting.
Yeah. So, but there's women's meetings, especially this weekend. I think I need to get to one. So there's different meetings. You know, you hear that all the time, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
If you don't like one meeting, go to a different one.
Go to a different one. Take what you like, leave the rest. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, some meetings are better than others. So you have to go to where you feel, where you get fed.
Exactly.
So, well, listen, great work on your writing exercises. I appreciate you digging deep and coming up with all those examples of powerlessness and unmanageability. I know it's not comfortable to look at all that, but great work.
Thank you. All right.
So you have step two. So when you're done, you just let me know. We'll schedule the next call.
Awesome.
All right. Awesome. Thank you so much. We'll talk soon.
All right. Thank you, Arlina.
Okay. Thanks.
One last thing before you go, if you enjoyed the podcast today, please don't forget to subscribe on iTunes or Stitcher and leave a review. And if you'd like to make a donation to the podcast and help me keep the lights on, you can do so by visiting odaatchat.com. There's a donation button or membership button on the right-hand side. Have a great day. Thank you so much for joining us.